after all, was invented in the 20th century, in the late 30s, and it is entirely characterized by, if it is characterized by the people who took it, then it is entirely characterized by 20th century Europeans and Americans, very largely. A compound like psilocybin, on the other hand, used for millennia by tribal peoples in the mountains of Mexico, would then, of course, have a completely different kind of morphogenetic field. I think there's a great deal of research to be done here. Sasha Shulgin years ago wrote a paper called Quantum Mechanical Correlate to Hallucinogenesis, in which he showed that very powerful psychedelic substances became completely inoperable by the moving of a single atom in the structure. Well, now that's a very elegant and materialistic demonstration of the primary connection between matter and mind. At least that's how I interpret that.
You've mentioned that psilocybin facilitates contact with what appears to be another mind or an alien intelligence of some sort. You have a theory about UFOs which suggests that they might somehow be projections of this intelligence out of the psyche. Could you talk about that a little bit?
Well, sure. Psyche or consciousness is a very, very slippery concept. Even figuring out whether one has it or not, that's not always easy. And, you know, one researcher, Julian James, has suggested that human consciousness has changed its character even in historical times, that in Homeric times, the ego as we know it was really not in existence except under situations of extreme stress, and then it presented itself almost as an exterior intrusion into consciousness, like the voice of a god or something like that. I think that the major difference between, let's call it modern materialistic consciousness and let's call it archaic shamanic consciousness is that the archaic shamanic consciousness interprets much of its perception as coming from an organized and intelligent other. And I, after having gone through the extraterrestrial interpretation for a number of years, have sort of come out to the opinion that this other that we contact through these things is nothing more or less than a kind of integrated intelligence that pervades the entire planet. For want of a better tag, let's just call it the Gaian overmind. And I think for a long, long time before history, people were fully conscious, fully at home with language and humor and theater and ritual and magic, but they were cradled, if you like, or embedded, if you like, in an almost continuous dialogue with the rest of reality, experienced as a seamless consciousness, which they called the Great Spirit or the ancestors or simply God. And that the Western cultural and linguistic heritage has been largely a building of defenses against this other and a replacement of it with the politically expressed mass ego of humanity. So when we go into the wilderness, and certainly when we go into the wilderness and take psychedelic plants and perform ancient paradigmatic rituals and this sort of thing, if we are successful in dissolving the conditioning and the expectations of modernity and materialism, we discover that this thing is still there, still alive, still capable of dialoguing with us. And it's absolutely confounding to people. And they react to it either with ecstasy or fear, either with tales of religious conversion or alien abduction. It entirely depends on how it hits you. In this case, one man's revelation is another man's nightmare. But the thing that lies behind all of this is a living, intelligent, natural mind of some sort that is simply an extension of the biosphere of God.
You deal with some of the historical dimensions of the use of hallucinogens. You envision the history of culture as a kind of a steady decline in the use of plant-based hallucinogens and their gradual replacement with such unsatisfying substitutes as alcohol, opium, tobacco, cocaine, heroin, and so forth. Is it possible that if people used hallucinogens in a more ritualized and controlled way, such as, say, twice a month, that it might significantly reduce the abuse of these other drugs?
Oh my God, twice a month would be a revolution, wouldn't it? I think people without this helping hand from this Gaian intelligence that we were talking about, people just simply are clueless. And they have, you know, Marxism and modern advertising and whatever cultural values they're born into to guide them. But inevitably, these things, as Freud pointed out in Civilization and Its Discontent, these things lead to neurosis. So I think that the key thing to understand about the psychedelic experience, whether you love it or hate it, is that what it does is it dissolves boundaries. And it dissolves cultural programming and replaces it with a much more basic kind of programming that is in the human animal, and that all culture steers us away from this original source of self-authentication. And in that sense, Freud was right. All civilization is neurotic. So in the book you mentioned, and also in another book of mine called The Archaic Revival, I simply pointed out that when civilizations become massively neurotic, they seem to have an instinctual reflex to go back in time looking for a model. This is why the Renaissance created classicism as a response to the failure of the medieval church. And it's why in the 20th century we've seen outbreaks of phenomena that range from rock and roll to cubism and surrealism and so forth. These are impulses toward an archaic state of mind. And I think that at the center of this impulse toward the archaic state of mind is the boundary dissolution of cultural values that takes place under psychedelics. And certainly, if we could find some way to bring this to people, and I think twice a month sounds massively more frequent than necessary. I think if you could bring people to this on a yearly basis, that it and in a powerful manner, that would be sufficient to keep people operating in the certain, in the light of the certain knowledge that there are larger structures than the value system being handed down through the mass media and cultural convention. I mean, people are being absolutely starved for authenticity. And in the meantime, they're offered an endless selection of German automobiles and hair care products and ice cream flavors and witless entertainment. And none of this satisfies, because what people really